Okay. This paper was prepared for a conference in Amsterdam with a title that was a question. All we need is science. And I figured maybe I would come right away suggesting, no, I think there's more to it than just science. So I begin with a quotation from Shakespeare just to make a point about literature matters too. This is from The Tempest. Miranda has just discovered she's not alone on the island. There are people she's comfortable with. Okay. Oh, wonder how many goodly creatures are there here. How beauteous mankind is. Oh, brave new world that has such people in it. Hence my title. I'm playing with this idea, Brave New World. Okay. When I think about the state of philosophy at the moment, I'm tempted to talk like Thomas Kuhn. I thought I would, if you asked me 10 years ago, I would say this would never happen. I would never sound like Thomas Kuhn. But I'm starting to when I think about the condition of philosophy, because it's very tempting to me to say the old analytic paradigm is very close to exhausted. And the people who used to do pure conceptual analysis seem to be looking around for something rigorous to do instead. And what they're doing in various ways, shapes, and forms is trying to ally philosophy more closely with the sciences. Oh dear. Okay. I think if you want to identify one document that started this trend, it was probably Quine's paper, Epistemology Naturalized, which of course is now decades old, but it takes a long time for this kind of thing to seep into the culture. I think that paper is one of the most ambiguous pieces Quine ever wrote, and Quine was pretty good at ambiguity. A student of mine once invented a wonderful word for how I would describe epistemology naturalized. It's not an English word, but it ought to be. Ah, she said, you're not saying it's ambiguous, you're saying it's very ambiguous. Yeah, it's very ambiguous. It has multiple layers of ambiguity. Nobody really knows quite what it was Quine was saying, including, I might say, Quine. I heard him respond to papers about epistemology naturalized at a conference in the late 80s, and it was perfectly clear he was not aware of the ambiguities. Okay, so what we've got is a host of different, disparate efforts to ally philosophy somehow with some science, and a host of new isms, enough to drive one crazy, naturalism, scientism, scientific realism, reductionism, blah, etc., etc. Another consequence, which I find very disturbing, is a tendency just to reject as not really real, somehow a kind of illusion, anything that the favored science can't readily accommodate. And there are numerous forms of this. People tend to call it deflationism, but I think that's a euphemism. I'm inclined to call it denialism. Right, because they just deny that obviously real phenomena are real because they can't explain them. I'm thinking, for example, of the Churchlands and Stitches repudiation of beliefs and desires. I'm thinking of the bizarre ethical and epistemological nihilism in recent work by Alexander Rosenberg. He gave a talk at this same conference. And after his talk, one Dutch professor, who was much quicker than I, said, I don't understand. Was that supposed to be a lecture, or was it some kind of theatrical performance? Because if you give a lecture saying there's no such thing as meaning, and there's no such thing as better and worse evidence, and what the heck are you doing? Okay. So my congratulations to that Dutch professor. For someone like me, this is awfully disorienting because I was never really exactly analytic. I was always more attuned to the old pragmatist than to the strictly analytic tradition. And I'm finding this exaggerated post-analytic enthusiasm for anything and everything scientific just about as disorienting as the postmodern distaste and disdain for anything and everything scientific. So here I am, as usual, trying to find habitable middle ground. I hope you won't mind one small mixed metaphor. Right? I am among friends, I hope. These are two nice English idioms. I'm out on a limb and I'm swimming against the tide. I keep thinking of a very nice passage from Aldous Huxley's book, Brave New World. This is this dystopian novel with a title drawn from Shakespeare. The controller, who is this political governor of everything, asks the savage, who is a human being who was, oh my God, born instead of being grown in a test tube, if he knows what a philosopher is. And the savage, who has never read anything except Shakespeare, which is forbidden, says, oh yeah, I know what a philosopher is. It's a man who dreams of fewer things than there are in heaven and earth. So disoriented, I didn't know where to begin. And then I remembered this marvelous observation by somebody whose name I can't pronounce, but you can. Think before you think. So what do I think? I don't think there's mental stuff. I'm not a Cartesian of any kind. I don't think there are souls. I don't think there are spooks, nothing of that kind. I think all the stuff there is physical stuff. Though I grant you, defining exactly what physical means is actually very challenging. But I also think that human beings are minded, I'm deliberately using a made-up word, in a way, or I better to say, to a degree. No other creatures are, so far as we know. I don't know what there might be out there in the rest of the universe. But. And I think this mindedness has enabled us to create social institutions, a vast array of artifacts from everything in this room except the people, and including intellectual artifacts like the contents of these books, and imaginative artifacts like the contents of some of the other books, I take it. I don't think that this is in any way a mystery or inexplicable, but I also don't think that it can be, more importantly, that it could be fully explained by the concepts and the laws of physics. Okay. I had a very nice line in Defending Science, but I had no idea how hard it would be to spell it out. I said, it's all physical, all right, but it isn't all physics. I didn't know it would take me 10 years to figure out what I meant, but, well, it did. All right, so let's start with some metaphysics. Here's what I think about what there is. The world is very complicated. It's very multifaceted, it's many-layered. It includes physical things, physical events, physical phenomena, physical kinds, physical laws, etc., etc. And these physical constitute not just the Earth, they constitute the universe, which may be, for all I know, only one among many multiverses. I asked Google what it could show me about multiverses, and that was terribly confusing, but that was as good as I could get. But in our little corner of our universe, which is, by cosmic standards, tiny, there is, over and above, all the physical things, phenomena, laws, kinds, etc., etc., our mental states and processes, our beliefs, our hopes, our fears, all the social institutions, all the social roles, all the social rules we've brought into being, you know, the legal systems, for example, all the physical artifacts we have made, the roads, the bridges, the computers, the clickers, etc., etc. and a whole raft of intellectual artifacts, mathematical, scientific, historical, philosophical concepts and theories, all made by us. Imaginative artifacts, novels, poems, plays, TV dramas, video games, cartoons, etc., etc., etc. All also made by us. These are all real, according to me. That doesn't mean they are all existent entities. Ugh, God, I hate the word entity. If I could banish it, I would. It's so confusing, and it gives students the impression that they've sort of grasped something that they haven't. As I use the word, which is also roughly the way Peirce used the word, real is a broader concept than exists. Exists is the mode of being of particulars only, and not everything that's real is particular. What I mean by real is roughly independent of how you or I or anyone believes or wants, etc., it to be. Doesn't mean independent of us. If real meant independent of us, this microphone would not be real because it wouldn't exist if we hadn't made it. It can't mean independent of our minds, because if that's what it meant, what you're thinking at the moment and what I'm thinking at the moment would not be real, but it is real. It means something subtler than that, roughly independent of what you or I or anyone believes about it. I call this theory, it's a metaphysical theory, and I've been working on it on and off. You know, it's like the project in the garage that you've got more or less going, and then you go back and tinker with it and make it a bit better. I call it innocent realism. I typed innocent realism into Google Images. I got several photographs of myself, yeah. And this is the perfect. Okay, that's what I'm doing. I'm looking out the window at what there is, trying to figure it out. It is, if you like, inductive metaphysics I'm doing. Many aspects of this world, I think, just seem on their face resistant to being described or explained in terms of physics. For example, a scientific theory, like Darwin's theory of evolution, or a novel, like Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin. And I've chosen these, of course, because they are both extremely influential texts. Both of them are texts that, in some sense, change the world. Perhaps you're not familiar with Uncle Tom's Cabin, but it's sometimes described as, Harriet Stowe is sometimes described as the little woman who started a civil war, right, because this was such an influential book. So any exemplar of either of these books is a physical object describable in physical terms, right, made of paper and ink and string and glue and whatever. Or an electronic version, also describable in physical terms, though I wouldn't know how to do it myself. But you can't describe their content in physical terms, and you can't describe their influence in physical terms either. To say, for example, that Uncle Tom's Cabin was an important factor in setting off the American Civil War is not to say something, I think, that any physics could explain. Or think of, I like this gadget, this is Jevons's logical piano. Basically, you put the premises in, turn the handle or press the keys, and it churns out a theorem for you. It's called the logic piano. Well, it's made of physical stuff. It's describable in physical terms, as is a computer, which is simply a much more sophisticated version of the same idea. But its function can't be described in physical terms. And neither can the fact that Peirce saw the very same function could be performed electrically. He actually had the first concept of what a computer would be. This is too good a story not to tell you. Peirce had a student, Alan Marcond, student in logic. And Marcond saw Jevons's machine when it was brought to the States and wanted one. He wanted to have one of his own. He said he was going to build one. He hired a carpenter. The carpenter started building a logic piano. And then he had a fight with the carpenter, and the carpenter walked away. What's he got? He's got a pile of pieces of wood and absolutely no idea how to turn it into a logic piano. So he writes to his old teacher. He writes to Peirce and says, what do I do now? And there's a letter that you can read from Peirce in his own handwriting, which says, I suggest you use electricity. Here's a wiring diagram, first idea of the computer. Or think of a legal system. The courthouses, the prisons, their contents, the records of rulings, these are all describable in physical terms, but not their purpose, or their content, or their effect. So what makes them resistant? I think that we bring them into being through human imagination, intellect, design, plans, choices, actions, and so on. So if I'm right that they can't be explained in terms of physics, it's because human-mindedness can't be explained in terms of physics. So that's the next task. All right, the human factor. What difference do we make in the world? There is an enormous amount we don't know about ourselves, as there is an enormous amount we don't know about everything else. Nevertheless, I'm quite confident that the same physical laws that explain how a cheetah can run so fast. Did you know a cheetah can make almost 90 miles an hour? That's amazingly fast. Or how a bird can fly. And those same physical laws explain why we can't run at 90 miles an hour and why we can't fly. Not by flapping our arms, anyway. And the very same evolutionary principles that explains how dinosaurs and dung beetles and dandelions evolved also explain how human beings evolve. And no doubt, I'm sure they explain our ability to walk upright, our vestigial appendices, the little toes that maybe in another million generations human beings will no longer have. Perhaps the theory of evolution can even explain our religious impulses. I don't know. Perhaps. Perhaps it can explain our capacity for altruism. Perhaps. I'm not sure. And there are certainly marked affinities between human capacities and other animals' capacities. Between our capacity for art, for example, and the nests that a bowerbird will make, decorated with all the pretty things that a male bowerbird can find to attract a mate. I've even read that the same gene that's thought to be responsible for how a songbird carries a tune is involved in the human capacity for speech. If true, is really interesting and exciting. I haven't even got to the primates yet. I mean, some primates are startlingly clever. Vervet monkeys, I believe, make different warning cries depending on whether what's coming is a snake or an eagle or a leopard or a human. Japanese macaques, one troop of them, figured out that you could clean the sand off sweet potatoes by washing them in water. Well, that's pretty smart. Okay, those are the vervet monkeys, and this is a Japanese macaque washing a sweet potato. Still, you know, it's a long way short of the sort of thing we do. No Japanese macaque, so far as I know, has ever made sweet potatoes au gratin. Never written a sweet potato cookbook, never sold a sweet potato cookbook on Amazon, for example. And so far as I know, those vervet monkeys, smart as they are, don't tell their children bedtime stories about the foolish little monkey who didn't heed the warning cry and got carried off by an eagle. So there's something different about us. Okay. Still, and I want to say, we do have capacities that go beyond other animals. Probably the best way to describe it is not, we have X and they don't. More, we have this combination of things in significantly greater degree than any of them. And this is what allows us to become minded in a way, so far as we know, no other creatures are. The word, by the way, minded, which I've used several times now, comes from George Herbert Mead, who was the founder of what's now called social psychology. He's probably one of the least read of the pragmatist thinkers. He was a collaborator of John Dewey's. Unfortunately, he writes terribly. Oh God, reading him is painful. It's as if the text was written by a constipated camel. You know, it's so awkward, which made him not very popular. On the other hand, I think in part the prose is so awkward because he's thinking things that are so new. He doesn't really know quite how to spit them out. But okay, anyway, I admire him, though I grant you his literary style is disgraceful. I would say we humans are self-aware, language-using, and we have beliefs and intentions, we make plans in a way no other creatures do. That's not to say everything we do is self-conscious, planned. No. Some of what we do is simply instinctive. It's explicable biologically. Some of it's just conditioned reflex. It's habit. Okay. It can be explained in a purely behavioristic way. Some of it is explicable as our acting out of haste or panic. When we don't do what's in our interests or what we intended to do because we're panicking. But much of what we do is mediated by our understanding of the world and our goals. Okay. After all, think of how you understand a work of history. Think of how you understand a novel. They all depend on understanding human behavior in these ways. Even weird science fiction novels ultimately depend on understanding behavior in these ways. I'm kind of fond of Ursula Le Guin, who has a very nice novel called The Left Hand of Darkness, the premise of which is these creatures are just like human beings, except they don't come in two sexes. They're hermaphrodites. And you know, in the appropriate situations, the relevant sexual organs pop out as needed. One chapter begins with the wonderful sentence, "My landlady was a voluble man." Oops. Still, you can't understand this novel without thinking in terms of behavior explicable in terms of beliefs and goals and so on. So does the law depend on these ideas. Two ideas from common law legal systems. Mens rea, which is the intent that's essential to a criminal offense. Scienter requirements. You can't be convicted of receiving stolen property unless you knew or ought to have known that it was stolen. Simply possessing stolen property is not a criminal offense. Knowingly buying stolen property is. Same thing is true of the intentional social sciences. I don't mean the intentional social sciences as opposed to the accidental ones. I mean not physical anthropology, which is about the bones and the artifacts left by these people, but sociological anthropology, which is about their beliefs, their activities, and so on. Here are some social scientific questions that seem to me essentially not within the reach of physics. What were the effects of the enclosures of formerly common land in 16th century England? this was a legal change. Land that used to be common, where anyone could graze a goat or a sheep, where anyone could collect firewood or berries or whatever, these were all enclosed. It completely changed the labor market. It was one of the most dramatic things to happen in English society in that century, or subsequently. Why did the US housing market collapse in 2007 and start to revive in 2030? Is the death penalty really a deterrent? Not a very difficult question. How did this mindedness arise? I think this is two questions. How did human beings come to have these capacities in this degree? And how do those capacities come to be realized in an individual person? I'm going to set the first one aside. I apologize, but it is just too hard. I don't know what to say. It's enormously difficult. A few people, I think, are beginning to make a little bit of progress, but it's really hard and way beyond my competence. I'm going to try to work on the second. With respect to the second, I believe we know that while the capacity for language is innate, all normal human beings have it. Acquiring this capacity, actualizing it, requires socialization. There have been a few experiments in raising human children absolutely in isolation. Only very powerful people can perform these experiments. One of them was Holy Roman Emperor Frederick II, who thought he'd discovered that if you just left children to themselves and completely isolated, they would end up speaking perfect Hebrew. I think somebody talked to them. I simply don't believe this experiment. He's not the only one. In normal circumstances, I think a human infant acquires language and becomes minded in the same gradual process, moving from initial babbling, mimicry, reinforcement, to gradual mastery of many, many, many internal connections between words, inferential links, between the words and the world. Normally, is a seriously intended qualifier. Because we need to accommodate some special cases of people who are very, very lacking in sensory capacity and yet somehow acquire the ability to communicate. The most famous is Helen Keller, who was both blind and deaf, but nevertheless acquired language sufficiently well to write her life story. And the much less well-known, a remarkable artist called John Castle, who was stone deaf from birth, never learned sign language, but nevertheless could communicate through art. Right, so I think if I were to turn this paper into something much more detailed and careful, the references to language use would have to be transmuted into references to sign use, to the capacity for semiosis, which is broader than the capacity for language. How you learn language is a very, very complicated matter. I'm going to tell you two stories you might like. The first is about the very small daughter of a friend of mine. I was visiting when the daughter was two. And we were in the garden with her. They had a kumquat tree in the garden. And because the child was wandering around the garden, we had to explain which fruit she could eat. So we said, look, the orange kumquats are ripe. You can eat those. The yellow kumquats are almost ripe, but leave them. They will be better next week. The green kumquats are unripe. Do not touch them. They will give you tummy ache. You know, this kid listens, and we think the lesson's gone in. Pay no more attention to it. Shows up at breakfast the next morning with her teddy bear. And out of nowhere, she says, teddy bear's almost ripe. She's done the wrong induction. Isn't that interesting? The teddy bear's yellow. Teddy bear's almost ripe. Okay. The other story is from a very, very sad case, the Martin preschool case, where all the teachers in a kindergarten were accused of sexually molesting the children in their care. The whole thing was the fabrication of a hysterical mother. But of course, even though they were all acquitted, they were all ruined. You know, they'd lost their houses because they had to mortgage them to pay for their defense. And nobody would hire them because what if it was true after all? Okay, they were acquitted, but maybe the proof wasn't good enough. Well, I once got very interested in the role played in this case by therapists who were supposedly recovering suppressed memories in the small children. And there's a big book which contains transcripts of all the interviews of these little kids with therapists, which is where they got the supposed evidence from. I'll never forget one of them. One of them's called Tonya. She's 4 and a half. And the therapist is trying to get something out of her. You know, did the teacher touch you? Are you sure? Teacher didn't touch you there, did she? Therapist can't get anything. And she's obviously becoming very frustrated. Tonya, do you know the difference between the truth and a lie? Tonya, do you know what a lie is? It's kind of brownish, and it has big teeth. She doesn't know the difference between a lie and a lion. That gives you some idea how complicated learning language is. Just two nice anecdotes. The social interactions that make us capable of using language or other semiosis also make us capable of the complex, interweaving, explicitly expressible beliefs, hopes, fears, plans, etc. And these are a distinctive feature of human mentality. I am not denying our brains are made of physical stuff. Of course they are. I'm not denying a chemical imbalance can change a person's mood. I'm not denying a brain tumor can change a person's personality. There is a well-documented case of a happily married man with several children getting on with his life who suddenly starts taking an interest in prepubescent girls and hanging around schoolyards. He was actually a convicted sex offender and in prison said, you know, I have the worst headache ever. On a scale of 1 to 10, this headache is a 12. I've got to see a doctor. He saw a doctor who had the wit to conduct a brain scan, discovered he had a brain tumor, and when they took out the tumor, the urges went away. I'm not denying any of those things. I am only claiming these mental states have content. Okay. What about belief, for example? I think it involves a really complicated, multiform dispositions to behavior, verbal behavior and nonverbal behavior, all of which is realized in the brain. Somehow, I would say, in connections between what I call receptors and activators. That's not neurophysiology. These are not neurophysiological terms. That's whatever it is that neurophysiologists discover does the receiving or does the activating. That's what I mean. But the content of these beliefs is only explicable by the relation of these dispositions, both to things in the world, to words, and to the relation of the words to the things. This is a very complicated triadic relation. Hang on, you're saying, if you're really following this, you're getting anxious now. I said language was one of those human creations. Doesn't that make my account circular? Don't think so. Because I think that language use and the capacity for full belief develop together, hand in hand. That's actually part of the reason little Tonya is so interesting. She's 4.5. I would say she doesn't yet quite have the capacity for full belief, because that involves having some grip on the difference between true and false, which she doesn't yet have. Okay. All right. How exactly do beliefs and desires explain our actions? I wish I knew exactly. I don't. But I think I can get closer by starting with something really, really low level, relatively speaking. Okay. Think about an elevator. Okay. I couldn't, of course, tell you how it works exactly. I couldn't design one. If it breaks down, I couldn't fix it. But I'm confident we all agree. We can explain how, if you press this button and then you get in and close the door, if it's working right, it goes to the 8th floor. And I think we can do this in purely physical terms, right? In terms of the connection between the button that reads 8 and the mechanism that takes the thing up and stops it on the 8th floor. Okay. All right, now think of the cat. She was half wild, a delightful creature. We managed to persuade her that it was okay to accept food from us. And gradually, she got so used to us that she would show up on our deck to be fed 10 minutes after the alarm clock went off in the morning. Well, cats have very sharp hearing. We began saying, she thinks the alarm clock is the breakfast bird. She thinks when the alarm clock goes off, it means breakfast is coming. That's why she shows up. But of course, I don't think she believed in the fullest sense. When the alarm goes off, food will be forthcoming. I think she could be explained by a behaviorist. She had been conditioned to show up when she heard that sound, because food was coming. That was a reward, reinforcing this behavior. In her case, there is a connection in the brain between this sound and the availability of food. And we can explain her actions in a Skinnerian way. But embedded in those explanations, those Skinner behaviorist explanations, is a purely physical explanation, just like the elevator, about the connections between those things in her brain that are connected to the sound and the availability of food, and getting her legs moving towards our deck. Okay, how is explaining human behavior different? This is my favorite cat cartoon from The New Yorker. I don't know if you can see it at the back, but near the top of a very tall tree is a cat who is, however, calling home on his cell phone. And what's he saying? Uh-oh, I've done it again. Why is this funny? Well, because cats are really good at climbing up trees and really terrible at getting back down. Okay. Well, this is very funny. Why is it funny? Well, it's funny precisely because we know a cat can't do that. Right. A cat will just climb up the tree because that's what cats do, and then have great difficulty getting down again, but there's no way it will say to itself, oh, darn, that was stupid, which is what this is, which is what human beings do. Okay. Does this mean human actions are inexplicable? No. We explain them every day. He left early for the airport. He thought there would be heavy traffic. He made an excuse because he really didn't want to have to be at that meeting. You know, he didn't want to vote on this because either way he would make enemies. This is the plot of half the detective stories ever written. He killed her because she was the last person between him and the family fortune. So how do they work? What explains my going to the fridge to get a bottle of water? I would say my desire for water and my belief that there's water in the fridge. What gets me moving? Physical things. Something in my brain moves, something in my legs moves, something in my arm opens the fridge door, takes out water. But which things in the brain fire depends on what things in the world and what words they're associated with. Back to the cat. The explanation of her behavior is similar in structure, but without the linguistic, the semiotic element. Does that mean in our case the semiotic element is redundant? No, because that's the aspect that explains why we can say, oh darn, that wasn't what I meant to do. I forgot. Ah, you know, I just did the habitual thing and I realized last week there's a better way of getting there, and so on. But embedded in the explanation of human behavior, as embedded in the explanation of feline behavior, is the same sort of physical explanation as with the elevator. I hate to tell you this, but the last 15 minutes were me saying, Descartes, please go away. We don't need mental stuff to explain human action. We can explain it with only physical stuff if the explanation is sufficiently sophisticated, I think. Okay, what does this show us about the limits of reductionism? We are now in the face of many very ambiguous expressions. I would say my approach is, in a sense, realist. It's certainly not nominalist. Think of the real kinds, the real laws, the real phenomena. It's not idealist. It's not relativist. It is, however, about as different as it could be from Putnam's notion of metaphysical realism. I think Putnam did realism a grave disservice by inventing this mythical figure, the metaphysical realist, who believes a completely crazy theory and puts everybody off realism. It's also not remotely like those forms of scientific realism that read the metaphysics off the most recent scientific theory. Very different from that. It's also, in a sense, naturalistic. It certainly isn't a purely a priori theory. Right? It's based on looking out that window. Looking at what the cat does, looking at how the elevator works, at how human beings work, about how we explain human behavior. So it's not a priori. It's certainly not a priori metaphysics I'm offering you. Moreover, I'm acknowledging... What happened? What happened? Okay, I'm going back. All right, okay. I didn't do that. You have to explain how he did it, not how I did it. No, I went the wrong way again. What happened? Okay. I'm acknowledging the contributory relevance of scientific results to philosophy. I think they can be highly relevant. But it's not naturalistic either in the sense of Alvin Goldman, who thinks somehow cognitive psychology is going to answer the questions of epistemology. No, it's not. Sorry, Alvin. That's why the first half of the epistemology and cognition is completely unconnected to the second half. Alvin Goldman hates me because I read his indexes. And if you read somebody's index, you can discover all kinds of incriminating things. So in epistemology and cognition, the notion of a normal world, which is crucial to the epistemological analysis of the first half, nowhere occurs in the second half, which is where all the cognitive science happens. Okay. And in knowledge in a social world, there is absolutely no reference to evidence except in the chapter on the law. Okay. Sorry, shouldn't have told you that. It's not naturalistic in Goldman's sense, and it's not naturalistic in the Churchland sense either. I'm not trying to tell you that philosophical questions are misconceived and should be replaced by scientific questions. That's not my thesis. as you will have noticed, when I use the word scientism, it's pejorative. This is the normal English meaning. If you look in any decent English dictionary, it would tell you scientism means being too deferential to the sciences. So it makes me crazy when Alexander Rosenberg, for example, tries to make the word neutral. Right? Makes me even crazier when he says, let's call the view that all atheists share scientism. What? There's a perfectly good word for the view that all atheists share. Atheism. Right? We don't need another word, and we especially don't need a word with an established meaning given a new one. Okay. If that's what scientism means, being too deferential to science, the serious question is, what constitutes scientism? How much deference is too much deference? I believe one sign you've gone too far is you look to the sciences for answers beyond their scope. However, there are many complications, enough to make a person crazy. One is the English word science tends to be used much more narrowly than, for example, the German. So Wissenschaft is much broader than the English word science. So in English, physics, chemistry, biology, the medical sciences, sociology, psychology, physical anthropology, these are sciences. Jurisprudence isn't a science, for example. The idea of a science of law would be laughed out of court in modern English. That's a complication that I don't really quite know how to handle. There's also the problem about, well, what can current science explain versus what might some hypothetical future science explain? And of course, it's very difficult to know what questions a future science might be able to explain. If we knew that, we wouldn't need to do the work. However, I'm willing to go this far. I will bet the house no future physics, no future psychology, slot in whatever scientific discipline you choose, will ever tell us what makes evidence better or worse, whether making true predictions indicates that a theory is likely true, or answer any of those epistemological questions, because any scientific work presupposes the answers to these epistemological questions. I didn't need the crystal ball to tell you that. I was just joking. Nor, I think, could any future neuroscience, however brilliant, tell us whether religious experience really is or really isn't interaction with a deity. It could tell us all kinds of things about this experience and its sources and, you know, the similarity among Buddhist monks and Catholic nuns and whatever, I don't know. But not whether or not it's bona fide religious experience in that sense. Nor, I think, could any future biology tell us whether altruism is really a virtue or empathy is really the basis of ethics. It could tell us a lot about the origins of altruism or the origins of empathy, but answering those questions would be philosophical no matter what the biology did. Nor, I think, could a future sociology explain the meaning of the rule in American law known as the Four Corners Rule. I thought it was worth telling you about this one. It's such fun. The Four Corners Rule says you may not introduce in court part of a document. You must always introduce the document as a whole, all four corners of it. Nor could it explain the meaning of the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, which says there shall be no establishment of religion. No sociology could explain how that came to mean over two centuries of legal interpretation. Among other things, you may not put a sticker in the biology book that says the theory of evolution is only a theory, not a fact. Of course, though my approach is physicalist in one understanding of the term, it's not reductionist. And this is confusing because physicalism and reductionism are often equated. By my lights, these are different, independent positions, one true, the other false. I can imagine an obdurate reductionist, think Alexander Rosenberg, saying, look, the problem's just computational. You know, it's like trying to predict a hurricane. It's not that the thing isn't entirely physical and entirely explicable by physics. It's just that we're not clever enough. There are too many variables. I actually disagree. This is probably the most, this is where I'm sticking my neck out furthest. I'm not sure about hurricanes. But even if hurricanes are entirely explicable by physics, I think a complete reduction would be possible only in a completely deterministic universe. And that means a universe with no probabilistic laws, no randomness at all. And I don't believe that this world is like that. Just imagine what would be involved in explaining the history of English in terms of fundamental physics. And you'll get some idea why I'm going, no, I don't think so. The world has a history. The history is marked by singularities, by cosmological similarities, by the evolution of the elements, by the evolution of the species on Earth, by accidents, unique events. Yes, there are real laws, but there are still elements of chance. And very small elements of chance can have enormous consequences. Peirce called this idea tychism, which is a perfectly good word for it, and I will use it. This is, I am a tychist. You might be thinking, there's a really simple argument that shows she's out of her tree. Right. Look, physics is the science of physical stuff. You just said everything there is physical, so physics can explain everything. I say, no, sorry, the premise is ambiguous. Physics is the science that tells us what laws govern physical stuff, which is true, but it doesn't yield the conclusion. The laws of physics explain everything that's happened in the course of the history of the world and of human civilization. That would give you the conclusion, but I believe it's false. One last thought. I wrote this last section because of I knew what the motivation of the people in Amsterdam was. I am not going to introduce a new word, though I'm sorely tempted. Religionism, theologism, for the idea that if you reject scientism and you reject reductionism, you must have a religious agenda. I am only going to say, well, if you can't read in the back, those are the divinity graduates wearing their halos as well as their academic dress. One, no, it doesn't imply this. And two, I have no such agenda. Thank you. Phew.
So thank you very much for the lecture. I think that we have some time for possible remarks or comments or especially questions. I'm in a privileged position because I read your slides previous to the lecture, so I basically noted some remarks. But I would like to encourage you, if someone of you have the question in mind, please feel very welcome. Use the microphone if it's possible, because it's a bit better.
Yeah, I have a question because you distinguish between what is existent and what is real. Mm-hmm. The distinction which more or less is by Charles and their first and this school. So I have a question, how the first thing you say that you believe that everything there is physical. Mm-hmm. So you mean by is the existential say way.
Okay.
So for example, because it would be pretty hard to believe that, for example, laws are physical in a way that this chair is.
Yes,
physical.
Absolutely, yes.
So the physicalism is, well, kind of in the area of the existent, but not necessarily in the area of the real. So, or
okay, yes. I said, okay, remember I said, in defending science, I said, everything's physical, but not everything's physics, right? And then it took me 10 years to figure out exactly what I meant. You're perfectly correct. A much better way of saying everything is physical, which was a form of words I used in this lecture, is all the stuff there is physical, right? Of course, there are physical laws, but that doesn't mean that laws are physical in the sense in which this is physical, right? So physical sort of goes with exists, right? But exists is what goes with stuff, right? So what I'm trying to do is to, okay, on the one hand, I'm denying something. There is no mental substance, right? There aren't non-physical kinds of stuff, right? That's very important to me. This is not a dualistic picture, okay? But at the same time, I'm trying to expand your conception of the real so that it includes, most importantly, laws which really are independently of how we believe them to be. You know, we can be wrong about what the laws are governing physical stuff, but these are neither additional physical stuff, right? Nor are they abstract entities floating around in some Platonic heaven. They're patterns among the physical stuff, right? So what I'm trying to do is avoid both Cartesian dualism and what would it be, a kind of not Phrygian but David Lewis type pluralism of different kinds of existent entity, but expand the scope of the real. That's what I'm trying to do.
So you're trying to kind of like making more narrow the Persian idea of the second, of second, because
that's right.
To Peirce, I think that, well, obviously he was anti-Cartesian, but at the same time, the area of the second doesn't stop by, it's not reducible to the area of physics or physical stuff. So, for example, according to Peirce, as I understand it, for example, psychological entities, what we experience, I don't know, subjective kind of phenomena, would be also second, but not necessarily physical.
Yes, okay, so second goes with particular, and it includes both what he calls the outer and the inner worlds. All of this is adapted from him. So my account of the real is actually quite close to the Scotistic idea that he uses on the way to his pragmatist conception of the real. And my insistence that our mental states, beliefs, hopes, fears are real, even though they're dependent on our minds, is also derived from him. The overall picture is somewhat different. I mean, I'm sort of doing to Peirce what Peirce did to Scotus, right? Using him as a source of ideas for figuring out my own picture of this. It's not pure Peirce metaphysics, but it is informed by Peirce, very much the way Peirce's conception of reality is informed by Scotus's. And you're perfectly correct. My initial formulation, everything there is physical, is not exact. All the stuff there is physical, is what I need to say. And while there are physical laws and physical kinds, physical is there used in, I guess, what Aristotle would have called something like an analogical sense. Right? It's like this food is healthy. The word healthy doesn't have the same meaning as in I am healthy. Right? And yet there's a clear connection. And that was what I was implicitly doing without making it explicit. I'm grateful to you for making me say it explicitly.
So let me ask you one question regarding this discussion. Can you specify any differences between your ontological picture of the word and the and Peirce's ontological picture of the word? Are there any differences or?
Okay. I guess first of all, okay, it depends what you mean. Do you mean are there any differences in extension, or are there any differences in the way I describe it? Okay.
In extension.
Okay. Well. It's easier to say. It's easier actually to answer the second question. I'll start with that and see if I can approach the other one. Peirce conducts his metaphysics. It's very strongly marked by the categories: firstness, secondness, thirdness. I find those categories sometimes extremely useful. If you look at the detail of my account of what belief is, for example, just like the account that Peirce gives in The Fixation of Belief, though it's not identical to it, but it has the same structure. His account of belief in The Fixation of Belief, even though it's earlier than any explicit statement of the theory of categories, has the structure 1, 2, 3. So does my account of belief. But unlike Peirce, my metaphysics sort of starts with a list. You know, this is what I think there is. This is what I think is real. Okay, and it's not from the beginning put in three boxes: firstness, secondness, thirdness, the way his is. It would be a very difficult scholarly job to arrive at a well-informed conclusion how close this is in extension in the end. And I'm not in a position to give you a good answer to that question. I think it would be foolish to try. All I can say is it's at least like his metaphysics in these two senses. It's nothing like, remember, the categories are universal. Everything has aspects of all three. So it's not like a dualism of a Cartesian kind. It's not like a pluralism of a Phrygian kind or a Popperian kind, because that does exactly what Peirce warns you not to do. It makes distinctions with an axe, and it leaves you, as he says, with unrelated chunks of being. Right? So it's not like that. And in that, it's very similar to Peirce's metaphysics. Whether if I could make Peirce give me a list, it would look like mine, I'm not sure. I'm pretty sure he would include possibilities, for example. So would I, but I'm not nearly as clear as him about how to describe them, where they fit in. So I actually deliberately kept quiet about them for the moment. Okay, but you can't have laws without possibilities. So,
please.
Speaking about analogies and similarities, I wonder in a similar area about any comparison you would make of your theory and the theory of Donald Davidson of anomalous monism, since I have had at least few similarities. Like, he's also physicalist, he's also anti-reductionist. I think he's stuck his neck even further. He said reduction wouldn't be possible even if the world were deterministic. And for similar reasons you have given, that is reasons having to do with meaning and interpretation and content.
Yes. Well, I think the answer is there might well be affinities. Okay, the first thing to say is I arrived at this entirely independently. Then people started muttering to me about Davidson. I go look at it and think, okay, yes, we're sort of in the same ballpark, as they say. Maybe I'm not enough of a Davidson scholar, but my impression is that he has an overall picture which is not dissimilar from mine in terms of the general level of there's no non-physical stuff, and yet not everything can be explained by physics. But so far as I'm aware, I may be just ignorant, but so far as I'm aware, He doesn't really have any theory about how this works in the particular. And I do. Right? I mean, I've got, for example, an account of what belief is, which is not all about interpretation. It's not all about the realm of discourse. It's about the world as well as about what the language is about. So I think of myself as having come at this from a more metaphysical, less philosophy of language direction, and perhaps having developed aspects of it that, so far as I know, he didn't. But if you tell me he did, then I just have to read some. Okay, so that, well, then. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Yes, that's a bit like this, yes. But you understand, I come at this qua metaphysician, qua epistemologist. Philosophy of language is a very, very poor third in the way I'm going about this. And partly because I think the core issue is actually about sign use and not specifically about language. And I mostly talked about language, but if I'm going to explain how it is that someone like Helen Keller or John Castle is clearly in mid-sense minded, I'm going to have to cast my net broader than language. But yes, when Bartek asked me, you know, this is my ideal list of the topics you would talk about. One of the things on the list was meaning. And I said, well, okay, this paper is all about meaning, but doesn't actually use the word. Okay? So yes, it is, but it's not just about linguistic meaning. It's about the significance of things. Yes.
Thank you. It was just mentioned before a moment that according to Davidson, if I understood it correctly, the reductionism is not even possible if we have the entirely determined word in the Laplacian mode. But I'm, to be honest, I don't understand why you think that it would be possible if we had a word like that. I mean, entirely determined. And what about chance and calculus of probability? So
that's the point. Yes, that's exactly the point. There are probabilistic laws. There is chance. You're going to be amazed. Right? You probably thought you would never hear me cite Nietzsche, but I'm going to cite Nietzsche, and I'm going to cite Nietzsche writing about what he learned from Schopenhauer, who was an enormous influence on him. Okay. Okay. Well, I've actually first time in public. Okay. Nietzsche is thinking about, you know, what it is to be a person, what it is to grow into yourself. And he says, you know, everybody really recognizes in their heart that there has never been and there will never be anybody exactly like them. Because we are all the product of a history which is unique to each individual. Right? This is an idea he got from Schopenhauer, apparently. And the first time I used this observation in print, I've never actually said this aloud before, but the first time I used it in print was when I was interviewed for a volume on formal philosophy. And I wanted to resist the idea that though I did a lot of work in logic, I'm a formal philosopher. And I wanted to explain, look, I'm very conscious that there's probably nobody exactly like me because my history is special to me. And there is Nietzsche saying everybody knows this. And this is all, in some sense, it's all the product of certain accidents. For example, almost certainly, one part of the explanation of the role of the crossword analogy in my epistemology is that my maternal grandmother, who who left school at the age of 12, right, so she was not an educated person, was fascinated by words and had me do with her every word puzzle in the newspaper every day. Right, now this is just, you know, an oddity. How did she get to have this oddity? I have no idea, but something to do with her history. And when you think about what's involved in tracing all that back, you begin to understand why we're all minded, but each of us differently. You understand? Yeah. I don't think the world is Laplacian. Never did. You know, maybe Einstein was right, and quantum mechanics will in due course be